Howdy, y'all. So, throughout the history of music in the United States, there's been a trend of white artists becoming very big in musical genres originating from black communities, such as rock, R&B, and hip-hop. And often, these artists have gone on to massively eclipse the success of the black artists working in their genres. So today, we're going to take a look at some artists who are examples of this culture vulture phenomenon, how the music industry prioritized them at the expense of black artists, and why they were able to become such world-dominating successes. So, when talking about white artists and black music, there's one artist whose name jumps to mind immediately. You could say he's the king of this phenomenon.
One threw a party in the county jail. The prison band was there and they began to wail. The band was jumping and the jump began to swing. You should have heard the knocked out jailbird sing that rock.
Elvis Presley was America's first rock and roll superstar, though most assuredly not its first rock and roll artist. Elvis's style was built upon his experiences growing up listening to gospel music in church, as well as his influences from early rock pioneers such as Little Richard and Sister Rosetta Tharpe. Many of his hits were covers of black artists, most famously, Big Mama Thornton's Hound Dog.
You ain't nothing but a hound.
Which Elvis covered to notch his first of 31 number one hits.
You ain't nothing but a hound. You ain't nothing but a hound dog. Well, you ain't ever gonna live until you ain't no fear.
Thornton would later call the track a song I got robbed of. And while his love for the music was genuine, with him paying homage to many of the artists who influenced him, his ability to outshine those influences stems in large part from his being white, and therefore more marketable. Elvis was certainly controversial, with his sensual dance moves famously being censored on television. But a level of controversy which may have limited the career of a black artist simply drew more intrigue to his. Now, if Elvis is an artist with a complicated relationship with black culture, our next artist is an unadulterated thief. You see, in the 50s, many radio stations refused to play music from black artists. But the music was really good, so, you know, they're not gonna just not play it. This led to white artists creating cover records of songs from black musicians that could actually get radio play, often with pitying compensation for the original artist. And there was one artist who was absolutely prolific in this scene. I'm talking nobody, but the number two artist of the 50s. He done came all around the world to be here tonight, Pat Boone.
You made me cry when you said goodbye.
Yeah, the Kendrick bit would have worked better if Boone had a single song that went hard. So, Pat Boone was essentially the bizarro Elvis. He also made his living on black music, but did so without even a hint of passion or sex appeal. This is most apparent on his cover of Little Richard's Tutti Frutti. Pretty good early rock track, right? You even got the band thrust into the beat. But then Boone got his hands on the song.
Oh,
Jeez. So, Little Richard was gay, and I don't know quite how to describe it, but this cover just emanates homophobia, which fits. Pat Boone is homophobic. This should legitimately count as a hate crime. And as opposed to Elvis's approach towards his impact, you know, acknowledging the debt he owes to the artists who helped his career, Boone takes the opposite approach, saying that he helped the black artists because the only ones that anyone remembers are the ones he's covered. Yeah, sure, Pat. But just so I don't come off as needlessly Boone bashing, let me say something positive about the man. He did write an essay in 2015 condemning racism. Well, to be more specific, he wrote an essay in 2015 condemning Barack Obama for using the word racism. To refer to a terrorist attack on a black church. Moving on. In the early 90s, hip-hop was really starting to pick up steam. Having originated in the 70s and 80s, the art form, steeped in the black experience, was about to experience its first major superstar.
I'm back, and I'm ringing the bell. I'm rocking on the mic while the fly girls yell.
Yeah, Vanilla Ice is the shining example of how a mediocre white artist can achieve massive acclaim simply by virtue of their race. In retrospect, Ice is universally considered a joke. People hear bars like,
good luck, I like my rhymes atrocious, supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, I'm in effect.
And can recognize that this man cannot rap, even if he was. But the marketability advantage white artists have compared to their black counterparts was on steroids for this man. His album, To the Extreme, sold 7 million copies. It was the best-selling hip-hop album ever, and it's still 13th, having sold more than all of these classics. And this same idea applies to artists who can actually rap. Eminem is the best-selling hip-hop artist of all time, but even he knows how much his whiteness contributed to that.
Let's do the math. If I was black, I would've sold half. I ain't have to graduate from Lincoln High School and all that.
It also helped him go super far in his music while maintaining his mainstream status. I don't think I can include this in my video, but look up Eminem Kim. Or better yet, don't. Even today, while there's not really any new genres of music to hop on, at least none that I'm aware of, we've seen white artists adopting black aesthetics in order to boost their popularity.
First things first, I'm the realest. Drop this and let the whole world feel it. Let them feel it.
I still can't get over her being Australian. But whereas white artists have been able to achieve great success in historically black genres, black artists have had a comparatively difficult time breaking into more white genres. Nelly may genuinely be the biggest black country artist of the past decade, purely on account of his hopping on that horrible cruise song. So, why are white artists able to achieve such acclaim? Well, a major factor, particularly in the earlier examples, were the structural barriers limiting the reach of black artists. We saw how radio stations refused to play tracks from black singers, creating an environment where the white singers were the only ones who could succeed. But as those barriers have fallen, another factor in the massive success of white artists in these genres has been the audience. Even in genres heavily associated with black people, such as hip-hop, the majority of the audience is still white. This would probably be the case based on pure volume alone, given that there's like 5 times more white people than black people in the US. But data from SoundScan says that 70% of hip-hop sales come from suburban white kids. Now, the methodology on this data is admittedly pretty dodgy, but virtually everyone who's looked into it since has come up with similar results. And I would like to submit for the record my little brother's vinyl collection. Yeah, I think it's safe to say that white kids love hip-hop. And while most listeners aren't going, oh hey, this artist doesn't have any melanin, I'm bumping this shit right now. I don't think it's a stretch to say that unconscious bias can come into play here. Let's not forget, the best-selling album did come from the dude whose name literally reminded you he was both very white and very corny. And this isn't to say that all these artists are bad. Everyone I've mentioned here does at least genuinely love the music they've built their careers on. Except Pat Boone. I don't think Pat Boone is capable of feeling love. But they do owe a debt of gratitude to the artists who've established the groundwork for them, and in some cases, literally gave them their biggest hits. And as the audience, we should make an effort to acknowledge the impact black artists have had in these genres, rather than giving all our attentions to the white megastars that overshadowed them. A goal that's already seen some progress, with stuff such as the new Elvis movie highlighting the black originators of rock and roll, and Little Richard's version of Tutti Frutti, absolutely dominating Pat Boone in modern streaming numbers. Moral of the story, in the long run, it doesn't matter how white you are. If you're Pat Boone, people will still hate you. Thanks for watching. Like, comment, and subscribe. A special thanks to my lovely patrons, who should be scrolling by right now. And another special thanks to my professor, because this whole video is an extra credit project. Haha! I've tricked you all, ensnared you into watching my homework. I'm playing the economy game. Oh, Pat, you're the boon of my existence.